Hello, class. Today we want to look at our last topic on business statistics 2, that is BMA that 102. And our last topic is on hypothesis testing. In this topic, we want to look at the overview of the concepts in hypothesis testing. We want to describe the procedure of hypothesis testing. We also want to look at what we refer to as one-tailed and two-tailed tests in hypothesis testing, and also the type 1 and type 2 errors that may be committed during the testing of hypotheses. The expected outcomes, of course, by the end of this topic, we want to know every student should be able to define what an hypothesis is, differentiate between the one-tailed and the two-tailed tests, describe the procedure of testing an hypothesis, and also test hypothesis about the mean of the when the population variance is known and when the population variance is unknown. So to start with, we want to define an hypothesis. What do we call an hypothesis? An hypothesis is a statement about a population parameter, about a population parameter developed for the purpose of testing. When we talk of an hypothesis, basically we are talking about that parameter, that statement that is made about a population parameter. And we have quite a number of parameters. For instance, the mean, the population mean, the population variance, the population standard deviation, those are all parameters. So any statement you make about a population parameter, any statement you make about a population parameter or that is developed for that testing is what we call an hypothesis. Hypothesis testing then is a procedure. It is a procedure that is based on two things. It is based on probability theory and also the sample evidence. And this process is which we use to test the hypothesis. Now, the procedure for testing an hypothesis. For one to test an hypothesis, we have six main steps that we follow. The first thing you need to do is state the hypothesis. State the null and the alternate hypothesis. So, what we refer to as the null hypothesis is that statement about the value of the parameter. For instance, when you say there is no significant difference between this item and the other, that is your statement, and that is the statement that we refer to as the null hypothesis, and it is denoted by H-naught. We have what we refer to as the alternate hypothesis. An alternate hypothesis is any other statement which is contrary to the null hypothesis. So it is a statement that is accepted if sample evidence provides enough evidence that the null hypothesis is false. So if we are able to know that if we are able to test and see that the null hypothesis is not true, then the alternate hypothesis is always accepted. The second step in testing an hypothesis is that you are supposed to select the level of significance. A level of significance is basically the probability of rejecting a true null hypothesis. Remember, in our previous topic on estimation theory, we said that we have a chance of making an error. So in hypothesis testing, if you make an error and reject a null hypothesis when it is actually true, then what you have rejecting of a true null hypothesis is what we are referring to as the level of significance. And there are two errors that may arise in this case. There are two errors that may arise in testing hypothesis. We have what we call type 1 error and type 2 error. To differentiate the two, type 1 error is committed when you reject a null hypothesis when it is true. Sometimes you may end up rejecting a true null hypothesis. If you do that, then you commit what we call type 1 error. Type 2 error is committed if you fail to reject a null hypothesis which is false. So you have tested your hypothesis and you have found that the null hypothesis you have found that the null hypothesis is actually false. However, you go ahead and accept it. Then you commit what we refer to as type 2 error. Now, step number 3, you are supposed to identify your test statistic. And we have quite a number of test statistics, depending on the kind of data or the kind of information you have when testing an hypothesis. So you may use your the standard normal distribution. Z-test is used when we are considering large samples. For instance, when the sample size is large, that is greater than or equal to 30, we can use Z-test. That is a test statistic. Then we have the T-distribution, the student T-distribution that is used when the sample size is small. We have the Fisher distribution, which we refer in short as F-distribution. The F-distribution is used when we are comparing variances, a ratio of two variances. And then we have the chi-square distribution, which is actually a non-parametric test. Step number 4 in testing the hypothesis is you are required to formulate an decision rule. And basically, what we refer to as a decision rule is a statement on about the conditions under which the null hypothesis should be rejected. Remember, in testing your hypothesis, we have said that you have the null hypothesis and the alternate hypothesis. And therefore, you will be required to make a judgment once in the process of testing on what conditions do you reject the null hypothesis and under what circumstances do you accept that null hypothesis. So you have to formulate a decision rule. The 5th step in testing the hypothesis is you are required to compute the value of the test statistic. You are required to compute the value of the test statistic. Now, the value of the test statistic is guided by step number 3. The statistic you identified in step number 3 is what guides you on number 5. Then the final thing that you must do in the testing of hypothesis is you are required to make a conclusion. In any test of hypothesis, you must draw your conclusion. Remember, you had hypothesized. You had made a statement about something. And therefore, you must make a conclusion on what you are testing. Now, before we proceed, we must understand what do we call one-tailed and two-tailed tests in test of hypothesis. This is very important in testing hypothesis because when you are reading your tables, remember you have a set of tables which you are required to read from the, you have the standard normal table, you have the T-distribution table, and we have the chi-square table. So for you to know what exactly you are required to get from the tables, then you must understand the concept of one-tailed and two-tailed tests. Now, when we talk of one-tailed test, a test is referred to as one-tailed if that the alternate hypothesis states a direction. If the alternate hypothesis states a direction, then we refer to that as one-tailed test. For instance, this is an illustration. If the null hypothesis states that the mean income of women is equal to the mean income of men, against the alternative, the mean income of women is greater than the mean income of men, then this is an hypothesis, the alternate hypothesis in this illustration is taking a direction, and it is taking a direction because of the word greater than. You can see, if I write in symbols, then I'm saying the null hypothesis, the mean income of women is equal to the mean income of men. That is what is written here in ones. And the mean income of women is greater than. Now, this aspect of greater than, this is what we are calling it is taking a direction. So you can only tell that an hypothesis is one-tailed if you see ones that describe a direction. For instance, greater than, less than, those are ones that describe a direction. Now, two-tailed test. When do we call a test two-tailed? A test is referred to as two-tailed if no direction is specified, if no direction is specified in the alternate hypothesis. Now look at this illustration. There is no difference between the mean income of women and the mean income of men. Against, there is a difference between the mean income of women and the mean income of men. Now you can see in our alternate hypothesis, there is no direction. You cannot define the direction that this statement takes. There is a difference. We are basically being told that there is a difference, but we are not given which direction, whether it is greater or whether it is less. And therefore, if you look at this, when we write the same in symbols, we are saying the mean income of women is equal to the mean income of men. Against, the mean income of women, the mean income, there is no difference between the mean income of women and the mean income of men. So you can see the not equal sign in this illustration. And therefore, when hypothesis takes this kind of a direction, then we refer to these as two-tailed tests. Now, we want to look at testing. How do we test? Now, and we will start with testing the population mean when the population variance is known. Testing the population mean when the population variance is known. Now, when the population variance is known, the population is normally distributed. The test statistic for testing the hypothesis about the mean is given by this formula. Z is equal to the sample mean minus the population mean divided by the population standard deviation divided by the sample size. Now, we look at an illustration to demonstrate this. A study by the Coca-Cola company showed that a typical adult Kenyan consumes 18 gallons of Coca-Cola each year. According to the same survey, the standard deviation of the number of gallons consumed is 3.0. A random sample of 64 college students showed that they consumed an average of 17 gallons of cola last year. At 0.05 significance level, can we conclude that there is a significant difference between the mean consumption rate of college students and the other adults? If we go to the solution or how we handle this, the first step in testing that illustration is we are required to state our hypothesis. That is the null and the alternate hypothesis. And you can see our null hypothesis is based on the population mean, because we are given the population mean for all the Kenyan adults, that they consume 18 gallons. So this forms our population mean, because that is describing the population. Against, the mean is not equal to 18. Now, remember, in our illustration here, we have asked, at 0.05 significance level, can we conclude that there is a significant difference? So we are only interested in knowing whether there is a significant difference or not. We are not interested in knowing whether the adults are consuming more than the students or the students are consuming more than the adults. We are not interested in that. And that is why our hypothesis then is becoming a two-tailed test. Because you can see here, it is taking the sign not equal to. The second thing we have said is that you are required to state your level of significance. So that was the second step in testing the hypothesis. And therefore, you have to state your level of significance, which is 0.05. Remember, this is given in our illustration, in our question, at 0.05. significance level. So that is something which is already given, and therefore you pick it from your question, and it is based on the level of confidence that you have. Then number three, you are to state your test statistic. State the test statistic. Now we are using the Zend test, and the reason why we are using the Zend test is what we basically call the standard normal distribution test. And the reason why we are using the standard normal test is because of the sample size. Here, the sample size that we have picked is 64. You remember in our previous topic on that we covered in about estimation theory, we said that a sample size is large if it is greater than or equal to 30. And therefore, since this sample size is 64, it is greater than 30. And therefore, we use the standard normal test. And that is why we are taking the ZEND test. Now, and this is the formula for the ZEND test. Step number four is we are required to state the decision rule. And we have said the decision rule is the condition under which you will reject or accept the null hypothesis. Now, in our illustration, we will reject, we will accept, accept the null hypothesis if the computed value, the value that we compute using this test statistic, if the value that we compute is less than or equal to the critical value. The critical value is what you read from the standard normal tables or the tabulated value. Number two, you can reject the null hypothesis. If you reject the null hypothesis, then the computed value must be greater than the tabulated value or the value that you read from the tables. So if we go to the normal tables or the normal tables that we normally use or we have previously used, then the standard normal value that is at 0.05 will be 1.96. This is the standard normal value, 1.96. And therefore, that leads us to step number five. In step number five, we are required to compute the value of the test statistic. The value of the test statistic, remember we are using the formula that we have just identified. So we have the sample mean. The sample mean is that which is computed from the students, the number of students that were picked in the sample, and the mean was 17. Then we have the population mean, which is 18, divided by the population standard deviation which we are given, and then the square root of the sample size. And that gives us negative 2.67. And the absolute value of that is 2.67. So, of course, the absolute value we know is when we want to get rid of the negative value. We just call it absolute. Now, step number six is for us now to draw the conclusion. For us to draw the conclusion, we need to compare this value, the value that you have computed, and the value that you read from the standard normal tables. So if you compare the two values, you will realize that the value that is computed is greater than the value that we read from the tables. And therefore, if this value is greater than this, we have said that we are required to reject the null hypothesis. In other words, the null hypothesis is wrong. And therefore, we reject the null hypothesis on this condition, the condition that the computed value is greater than the tabulated value. And therefore, our conclusion is that, yes, there is a significant difference between the mean consumption rate of college students and the other adults. So that is an illustration on testing an hypothesis when the population variance is known. What if the population variance is unknown? In most cases, you realize that when the population variance is unknown, then the samples are small. The samples are small. And the samples are small if they are less than or less than 30. If the samples are less than 30, then we call those small samples. So when the population variance is unknown, the population is normally distributed. The test statistic for testing the hypothesis about the mean, the population mean, is the t-test. Remember, you can see this is t-test, x bar minus mu divided by s over root n. We are using the student t-distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. And if you recall what we called degrees of freedom are the number of variables that are allowed to vary within a data set. How many variables do we have? We only have one variable, which is x. And therefore, we have n minus 1 degrees of freedom. And an illustration on this, you can see a manufacturer of automobile seats as a production line that produces an average of 100 seats per day. Because of the new government regulations, a new safety device has been installed, which the manufacturer believes will reduce the average daily output. And then a random sample is picked. So the question here is, assuming that the daily production output is normally distributed, is there sufficient evidence at 0.5 or at 5% level of significance to conclude that the average daily output has decreased, underline the word decreased, following the installation of the new safety device? The hypothesis test procedure is the same. You have to state the hypothesis. However, you realize that because we are interested with the decrease, this is a one-tailed test. It is a one-tailed test because the alternate hypothesis takes a direction. That is what we said. It takes a direction less than. The level of significance is given, and the test statistic in this case, we use the T distribution table or the T distribution because we are dealing with a small sample. We are dealing with a small sample because you can see we are taking a sample of 15 days. Only 15 samples are available. Then the decision rule, it is just similar to that of normal distribution, that we're supposed to accept the null hypothesis if the computant value of T is less than or equal to the critical value. And we are supposed to reject the null hypothesis if the computant value of T is greater than the critical. Again, the critical value is what I refer to as the tabulated value. So from the student's T distribution tables, and these are the tables we have used severally, if you compute this, if you check this value at n minus 1 degrees of freedom, then you will get the value is negative 1.761, because you are taking alpha, which is the level of significance, which you are given as 0.05, and 14. 14 is the degrees of freedom. Remember, the degrees of freedom are n minus 1. So we have 15, the sample size is 15. 15 minus 1 is 14. That is where the 14 is coming from. The value of the test statistic, here you are given raw data. If you go back to your question, you are not given the computant value like in the previous example. Here you are given the raw data. And that is why you are required to compute the mean. From statistics 1, we all know how to compute the mean. So you compute the mean, and that is 96.47. You compute the standard deviation, which is 4.85. And also, you compute the you get the computant value of T using the formula that we have just identified. So you will get the value as negative 2.82. Now, for our conclusion, you are supposed to compare the two values of T, the computant value and the tabulated value. Again, you realize that the computant value is greater than the tabulated value, and that leads us to rejecting the null hypothesis. And in our conclusion, we say that there is sufficient evidence to conclude that the average daily output has decreased following the installation of the safety device. Now, we can also test for proportions when we are given proportions. And I said a proportion is a part of a whole. For instance, when you are given that there are 15,000 people who are sampled to do something, and out of 14,000, only 10,000 manage, then our proportion is 10,000 out of 15,000. So the test statistic for the proportion is ZC is equal to P at. This P at, this is the sample proportion, and the sample proportion is the number of successes divided by the sample size, minus the population proportion. You can see the difference between the two P's. This is the population proportion. This is the sample proportion. then divided by, of course, the standard error, the standard error. So the procedure for testing the hypothesis is basically the same as what we have just seen in the two previous examples. We can also test for the difference between two sample means for large samples. When we talk of large samples in statistics, we are basically referring to those samples which are greater than or equal to 30. And therefore, if we have large samples and we want to test for difference between two sample means, somebody may ask, where does this arise? When you want to do a comparison of two items, for instance, if you are a trader and you get two deliveries, the first delivery of fluorescent tubes indicates that the lifespan of your fluorescent tube is 1,000 hours. And then you get a second batch, which is indicating that the lifespan is 980 hours. Then, as a trader, you will realize that there is a difference. The first batch is indicating 1,000, the second one is indicating 980 hours. That means the lifespan is not equal for the two batches. And therefore, one may be interested in testing whether there is a significant difference between the two batches that have been delivered. And because of that, you realize that in that case, we have to test for that difference. So in this case, the Z value is given by X bar minus this divided by the standard error, where the standard error is given by that formula. So again, we have an example there, and in that example, just like the previous examples, the procedure is the same. You are supposed to go through the six steps of testing the hypothesis and whether you are rejecting or accepting the null hypothesis. The same thing when the samples are small. The only difference is that in this case, you are supposed to use the T distribution table. So, very fast, I will go to the last item on these tests, the chi-square test. And on chi-square tests, there are three areas that we are interested in as far as chi-square tests are concerned. We have what we refer to as the test of goodness of fit, or chi-square test for multinomial experiments. We have test for independence of attributes, or chi-square test of contingency tables, and the test for homogeneity or similarity. And when we talk of testing for goodness of fit, basically multinomial experiments are generalized versions of binomial experiments that allows us to test for more than two possible outcomes in each trial. And for chi-square tests, just like the T and the Zend test, we have this formula here for getting the computant value, whereby you have the chi-square test. The computant value of chi-square is given by the observed values minus the expected values square root divided by the expected values. Of course, you sum them up. The rejection region is at the point where the computant value is greater than the tabulated value. So the same thing with the test for independence of attributes, whereby you are expected to test or to check whether there is any association or relationships between two or more attributes or not. And we have an example there of those people who took some drugs and others who never took, and they were cured and others not cured. And the process of testing still remains the six steps. Remember, there are these six steps of testing the hypothesis. So the steps are similar. The only thing that differs is how you get the expected values. And the expected values are given by the row totals multiplied by the column total divided by the sample size. That is what gives you. And therefore, you will have a table of your observed values, the expected values, and finally, of course, using the formula that you have just seen, it will give you the computant value of the chi-square. And once you get the computed value of chi-square, then you are required to read the table value. Once you read the table value, you draw your conclusion, just the same way we did in the previous examples. The last one is test for homogeneity or similarity. You can test for homogeneity in the same procedure, but we need to know that it is a concern. It is concerned with the proposition that several populations are homogeneous with respect to characteristic of interest. So in sometimes you want to test whether there is any similarity in the information that is given. So the test for homogeneity goes the same way as that of independence of attributes. The procedure is the same. So that is basically what is required in testing hypotheses, and the six steps that we started by looking at are the key things that you need to observe in any test. Basically, what I will say about test of hypotheses is that you need to be very keen on the statements that you are reading. When you are reading a question on a test of hypotheses, you need to be very keen on the wording so that you are able to differentiate what kind of test. Is it a t-test? Is it a chi-square test? Is it a normal distribution test? Or what kind of a test are you carrying out? Otherwise, that is it, and thank you for your time.
These televised lectures supplement our robust online learning going on our MKU online platform. You can view more on our televised lectures via our online platform. We are in a digital era, and Mount Kenya University knows this. The following are the steps to follow so as to complete your online application. Download the application form from the website www.mku.ac.ke. Attach copies of your academic certificates and ID. Pay the application fees via M-Pesa pay bill number 270988. Your ID is the account number. 2,000 shillings is the charge for a postgraduate. You can also deposit in the bank accounts provided on the website. Then email all the above to apply@mku.ac.ke.